very broad things like what happened in Paris.
Right.
Now, what do we do about those people who would commit such violent acts? Do we bypass them with your technique so they become irrelevant?
I wish, you know, I think there are many more important people, many more powerful people than me right now having that conversation of what do we do about these people. I think that there, you know, it's such a, obviously, I think such a wide range of things. I mean, I think, you know, in France, certainly you have, at some level, the police will have, I mean, this is a criminal issue that has to be addressed. At the same time, though, it's hard not to think, today already, that we're beginning to sort of talk about who these people were, the people that committed the crime. And I think they already found, I think, one guy who's French, who grew up in France, and until, you know, 4 or 5 years ago, the neighbors were saying he was totally normal, he would come and play with my children, etc. And then sometime along the last few years, he got radicalized. And the question is, of course, why him and not others? The question is, what purpose and what meaning are people finding? I think one of the, you know, everything I'm saying right now is not, I'm just sort of quoting things that you can read much better people than me about this. Clearly, ISIS at extreme, or Al-Qaeda, is offering people a way, an answer to questions and to sort of deep feelings of emptiness that people have. Here is a solution, here's a way. And right now, I think the choice of ways is not good enough, and I think that there have to be other ways to go and find meaning, to go and make a difference without having to go and kill a bunch of innocent people. So I'm not sure we can do anything about that specifically. That's not our role. We're just a nonprofit. But I think that what you can do is give people alternate ways of making life better that don't include that kind of thing, I think. And I think also this is sort of one last thing. I think there's a deeper piece about what I said earlier. I think if you go online today, or not just online, what you're going to find is tremendous sort of name-calling on both sides, right? This huge argument of should you blame all Muslims, not all Muslims, et cetera, et cetera. And I think that there's a huge need, again, to show that on both sides of every conflict, you have people who believe in freedom, dignity, life, et cetera, and who are willing to work together on that, and to give that voice, because the noisy people, the violent people, completely dominate the conversation. And there's something very, sort of in all of us, I think, in the way the media works, the way that we all live, there's something fundamentally unfair when you have a situation where, you know, in a city of 8 million people, 100 people will go out with, you know, drums or violence, they'll make the news. The 8 million people won't make the news. And there's something fundamentally imbalanced there. You have to find a way of expressing that.
Yes, I have a question. When you talk about this, excuse me, can you, we don't have a mic, so could you stand up so we can
sure,
hear?
Sure, I can talk very loud.
There you go. When you talk about the global world coming together, what do you do with the language barrier?
You have to drop it. I mean, you have to basically work multilingually. Certainly online, things are getting better and better. I'm surprised now, because, you know, when you're writing in English, you don't see what the other people see. So my girlfriend, it doesn't matter. My girlfriend is Spanish, she lives in Spain. And the other day I sent her this page that we built, and she looked at it, and she was reading the whole thing in Spanish. We haven't translated it yet. But the moment she brought it up on her browser, Google was basically translating it for her, and she was just reading it in Spanish. So I think we have to translate, technology is also moving. But yes, language is huge. And one small note about that, because again, you know, we all take things for granted. You know how we, those of you who use, you know, the internet, we'll talk about the web. And we talk about the web as if the web was one thing, right? This web. If you think about it for a second, there are so many, or there are many webs out there. If you think about when you go online, you go to any page, the links that you find on that page, naturally, in 99% of the cases, go to English-speaking sites, right? Think about it even more. In fact, most places you go to in the US, go to American sites, right? You very seldom land on some Australian site. And certainly, though, you're in this English world. And it's hard to forget sometimes that out there, there's this massive Swedish web and Japanese web of millions of websites connecting with each other in Japanese or in Swedish or in Greek that we never see, because there's no rational reason for you know, for an English site to suddenly connect to a Greek site. You know, like, oh, what am I doing here? But you have this entire world. So yes, we have to translate and we have to work multilingually. Otherwise, you fall into the same trap again of this sort of imperialistic one language, et cetera. So we're starting from the beginning in English, Spanish, and French, it's not enough, but we'll go beyond that. Yes?
The violence that we see is a consequence of violence. The ISIL people said that we're retaliating for the French bombing our people in Syria. So violence breeds violence. The cycle of violence continues. Now, there is a point where you have to face violence with violence, but that should be avoided. Now, during the time of Muhammad, people of the book, Christians and Jews, lived together in peace. What we have to do is find those clerics, Muslim clerics, which will interpret the Quran just as Muhammad did, and have them preach the fact that the way Muhammad conducted his relationship with other members of the book should be perfected. In other words, learn from Muhammad, and he is the teacher. Let people live with each other in path, in peace, and not have to resort to violence. You appeal to their religious beliefs, as stated by Muhammad, which I think would be more effective than resorting to force and having collateral damage, which only increases the violence that we have to face today.
So I'm not here as a spokesman for either violence or anything else. This is not the State Department. I think that and I'm certainly not that into Muslim theology. The one thing to focus on, though, again, and you can find this, one of the great things about, you know, the internet is that you can actually take a look at everything out there. And there's a fascinating debate going on, you know, for a long time now, certainly since the Charlie Hebdo issue in January, and also right now, there's a fascinating intra-Muslim debate going on. So the most fascinating person on the web is between Muslims about what they can do to move forward and what they think about this. It's a very complicated conversation that they're having amidst violence, amidst fear. So they're having this conversation. But none of this is easy, obviously.
So I'm just curious if you have any filters on your website.
Any filters?
Because the jihadist could think he's an idealist. Mm-hmm. And is it possible for people with less honorable goals to use your facility?
Which is why we do have these rules of no violence, et cetera. I think if you open the paper every day, most of what you find in the world that is bad, if you remove violence, all violence in the world, and if you remove attacks based on people's identity, I think you get rid of 90% of what's happening. So those rules are important. We have people on staff who look at every nonprofit, every organization that joins, and that's sort of adhere. And you know, yes, jihadists don't adhere to those principles, obviously. Beyond that, though, it's fascinating how for most problems in the world, you have organizations and people that are trying to do something to solve it. In most cases, you know, people talk about pro-life, pro-choice, pro-gun, anti-gun. Most problems, if you think about it, are not actually like that, right? There are very few people who get up in the morning and go to brainstorm, how do we create more breast cancer today, right? That's actually inexistent. You're trying to fight cancer. Most people don't go out and try to make certain things worse. Inadvertently can happen, it can be a consequence of other things. But most problems of that don't have somebody trying their best to make them worse. And so yes, we have those basic rules. I think I've been told the time is over.
Well, I'll take one more question.
Yes, please.
Yeah, well, I would like to thank you first for having such a great idea of getting nonprofits together in a place. My nonprofit benefited from connecting with music teachers here in the city, so thank you, I applaud your entrepreneurship. And I do have a question about, so idealist is great when you have you can connect to internet.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering what type of work you do with other nonprofit organizations in remote areas that their constituencies, they might not have access to internet. For me, it was very easy to go on internet and then connect with other people, but in remote areas all over the world, how you connect with those people that they don't have access first, and then how if you are working with Facebook, Google, because I believe Facebook is trying to get many more people all around the globe to have access to the internet. So those two things, how do you tackle with people they don't have access, and if you work with other organizations that they are trying to reach to those people?
So I'll try to keep it short. On the access issue, which was, you know, used to be called a digital divide, what you see more and more now, especially because of the advent of the phone that people have used, for the last year, I think, in India right now, many more people are getting a phone every month than a toilet. It's 15, 20 million people are getting a smartphone every month now. They're becoming extremely cheap. Also, people will go, it's amazing, some of you have seen these polls where they ask people, what would you sacrifice for a phone? What would you willingly give up, and vice versa, for your phone? And people would rather not eat than lose their phone. People are happy to give up sex and not their phone. It's sort of amazing. I do not want to give up my leash to the world. Literally. That's the answer that the people give. And so these things are penetrating more and more deeply. What you're finding more and more now, I think, you're getting to a place where the reason some people are connected or not, if you look at like every person in the world, why they're connected and why not, you get, well, choice is one, obviously, but you get to a place very, very soon now where it's not about technology access, it's about more foundational things, like the reason our village is not online is because we don't have electricity, we never have. Okay, so and without that, you can't actually get online. The reason all of us here are not online, doing, you know, fascinating things, is because we can't read. Hello, you know, you're not literate. You can't really use the web. The reason we're not online is because our dictator doesn't let us, and there's no internet in our country. So you get into those kind of issues where the reason some people don't have access is less to do now with real, straight technology, in some cases even money. And more to do with things like literacy, extreme poverty, absolutely. You know, I don't have this because I don't have anything, so of course I don't have this either. But then you have places you can go to get online, Wi-Fi is becoming much more pervasive. Sometimes it's enough for one person in a whole village to be online, and you can communicate from there, the priest, teacher, you can get the word out, radio is out there, so there are many other ways of reaching people. But the numbers right now are crazy. I mean, the fact that you think that Facebook, with all of you in this room that have made a choice not to be on Facebook, which is some of you who've made that choice, Facebook is already getting to 1.5 billion people. The penetration is sort of astounding, and there's so much more we can do. Beyond that though, yes, you have to use paper, radio, but whatever you can to get there. But then again, you run into these more foundational issues of poverty, literacy, freedom, where that's the real problem and not the availability of a device. Thank you.